the sun slipped down behind the tarp roofs, and day laborers are streaming home from 10-hour days ferrying materials to office buildings under construction, or trimming thorny bougainvillea on the manicured campus of a nearby private school. On this particular web of slum lanes, the caste lineage of most of the workers is Dalit, the untouchables of old. Most months, their financial situation boils down to what people around here call earn and eat. But for 2 years, the workers here set aside what little they could for bricks and mortar. And now they have a deep blue room, about 5 meters square, that stands distinct from all the other hand-built rooms in the slum. A temple devoted to Buddha in a Mumbai slum. This particular sacred spot is tucked behind a scrap dealer's. In the West, the Buddha is often seen as the original impersonal man, the extinguisher of his own personality. Indeed, after attaining his enlightenment, it's said he referred to himself as Tathagat, gone. But in modern India, paradoxically, the Buddha has helped hundreds of millions of low-caste citizens to be the opposite of gone or invisible. His ideas have allowed them to be newly present, to step outside the Hindu caste system's iron cage. Here, in this temple, put up more than 10 years ago, everyone is equal.
It was all built
together. So people from many different backgrounds came together to build.
Contribute capital and stay the, this manner.
Everyone contributed money, time, labor to build it. So it was very much a local group building, community. Buddha ne caste ke baare kya bola? What did Buddha say about caste?
Oh, caste ke baare mein kuch nahi. Ek hi dharma hai, Buddha.
So he has no caste, ne?
No caste.
Buddha is the first of 50 Indians I've chosen for this series. We'll be moving through a wealth of cultures and traditions, from ancient history to the age of global entrepreneurs. And as we go, I'll be doing more than bringing you closer to remarkable individuals who've shaped India and sometimes the world. I'll also be exploring their multiple afterlives in contemporary India and considering how collective memory, or its absence, illuminates many of the conflicts and astonishments of India today. The Buddha was born Siddhartha Gautama more than 2,000 years ago near India's northern border with Nepal. He turns out to be more interesting than the popular image, the sweet, sage, plump guy in the lotus position, half smiling. The founder of what is now the fourth largest religion in the world, creator of an ethical philosophy that's rightly been called one of the turning points in the history of civilization, he was also a political thinker. Today, he's often seen as challenging existing beliefs about caste, language, and even gender, subjecting them to the scrutiny of reason. Or is that just another modern incarnation? Charles Hallisey, professor at Harvard University's Divinity School.
In the 21st century, we often think that the Buddha was someone who was overturning the social order that he found around him. But when we look at the historical record, that seems less certain than we might hope for. It was a time in which people were willing to be open to all kinds of new possibilities, and he was in that mix. He was someone who was doing something that was different. Whether he stood out as a revolutionary, I think is not certain. My own opinion is that it's probably less likely.
The landscape of ancient India is shot through with revelations, like the Ajanta caves here, a gallery of wonders carved into the rock face. It's a foggy, dispute-ridden landscape too, with sources scarcer than for any other great civilization. But as elusive as some aspects of Buddha's life remain, I'd argue that he's the first recognizable complex individual in Indian history. Civilization on the Indian subcontinent dates back around 2,500 years before the Common Era. The composition of the oldest sources of Hindu belief, the Vedas, are placed roughly a millennium later. These mysterious verses about sacrifice and ritual could only be uttered by the Brahmins, one of the most self-protecting elites to have existed in any human society. Brahmin power was entrenched by Buddha's lifetime, but conditions were ripening for the emergence of alternative beliefs. Buddha arrived on the scene in an era of worldwide invention, from Plato's Athens to the prophet's Palestine to Confucian China. In India, trade with Persia and Western Asia was creating cosmopolitan cities that were bustling with commerce and with competing moral ideals. The Buddha lived in Magadha in today's Bihar, a region where rule was often by assemblies, dominated not by Brahmins, but by warrior and trading castes. And the Buddha himself was of the warrior caste, a Kshatriya. The story of how Buddha, born Siddhartha, came to create his own moral vision has as many variants as contemporary Buddhism has traditions around the world. It's in many ways an inward drama, a story of one man's psychological and ethical experimentation. Yet here, in these magnificently situated caves at Ajanta, near Aurangabad, we can see luminous paintings, some of them dating back to the first century before the Common Era, that tell us the bare-bones story of his life and that began to make it a universal one. After a cosseted upbringing, Siddhartha encountered human suffering and was shaken by it. But he was sufficiently undone that he renounced his wealthy family, taking up the life of a wandering ascetic. My body became extremely lean. When I thought I would touch the skin of my stomach, I actually took hold of my spine, he later said. After 6 years of fruitless struggle to find release from suffering, Siddhartha was jolted by a memory. As his father worked nearby, he'd sat under the shade of a rose apple tree in a state of pure joy, without sensual desires, without evil ideas, as he put it.
Unflagging persistence was aroused in me, and unmuddled mindfulness established. My body was calm, my mind concentrated and single.
How to recover that state? Days passed in mental struggle, but one spring night, while sitting under a Bodhi tree, he achieved it. Awakened, he now understood the cause of suffering and its cure. His path, the middle way, would avoid both asceticism and indulgence. His teachings became the Dhamma, it means very roughly law, principles to be followed, but also the principle or essence of things. The term was originally a Brahmin one, the Sanskrit Dharma, prescribing a different law for each caste. But the Buddha's Dhamma was an ethical vision encompassing all living beings. Identify oneself with all, he taught. Regard every creature in the universe with compassion. Buddha's solution to suffering lay in the individual mind, but he was also sketching a new form of society. His relative egalitarianism is clear even from the language he used to teach his followers. Brahmins fiercely protected the Sanskrit verses of the Vedas, forbidding the lower castes from learning this language of the gods. The Buddha, though, spoke not in Sanskrit, but in the local dialect of the people. And what's more, he dispensed with a priestly caste whose job was to provide access to the divine. Women were welcomed as nuns. He allowed low caste followers to be educated, a practice the Brahminic system forbade. And he rejected the idea that birth determined one's capacities and options. He was a moral meritocrat, and to an extent, a social one too. The Buddha's following grew by word of mouth, and then by imperial enthusiasm. In the 3rd century before the Common Era, not all that long after the Buddha's death, India's greatest empire builder, Ashoka, accelerated the spread of Buddha's teachings across the subcontinent.
We're moving along a very beaten up road past fields of paddy, and we're looking for one of the most exciting recent archaeological finds in India.
Ordinary, non-literate Indians were to learn of Buddha mostly through jatakas, popular morality tales, often carved as sculptural friezes at shrines and stupas.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.